Sure, we're all familiar with the classic Disney movie, Beauty and the Beast. Whether you are a fan of the original animated version or you liked the remake that was made a couple of years ago, it's a classic story. It's a great story. And there's a moment that takes place, and it actually is recreated beautifully in both versions of the movie, when Belle meets the Beast for the first time. Her father has already been captured by the Beast, and he is being held in a cell in the castle. And Belle is volunteering to take her father's place, to remain as the Beast's captive and let her father go free. But as of yet, she has actually yet to see the Beast fully, because he has been hiding in the shadows. And so she invites him, come into the light. Come into the light. And you can see that the Beast does it kind of hesitantly. He does it kind of slowly and unsure, because he doesn't like the light. He's much more comfortable in the darkness, because he doesn't like who he is. He doesn't even see himself as worthy of the love that he needs to break this curse, even though it's potentially for the first time standing right in front of him. So he's much more comfortable in the darkness. But that step into the light actually becomes the very first step towards him regaining his lost humanity. Because by stepping into the light at Belle's invitation, by Belle coming to see him more and more as the light shines more fully on him, she comes to see something that wasn't there before. And, well, I think you know the rest of the story. Like the Beast, the darkness can be a very comfortable place for us. See, we like to pretend that we don't know what our flaws are. We don't know what our weaknesses or our sins or our wounds are. But the reality is that they're probably the things that we know about ourselves the best, the deepest. But we try to put out this kind of comfortable persona to the world. We try to make it look like we are anything but our weaknesses and our wounds. We don't ever allow people into those darkest, deepest corners of our hearts because we're afraid, quite frankly, that if they were to see the fullness of who we are, they would run screaming in the other direction. But it's actually one of the hardest truths that we have to come to face. That if we are going to be truly loved, we have to be fully and completely known. We recoil from that idea, and we even pull away from God because of it. We even stop seeking perhaps forgiveness for our sins, because to ask for forgiveness means that I have to acknowledge that I have them in the first place. And so I back away. A lot like Adam and Eve, I try to hide myself from God in those moments. But God's not satisfied with that. God does not want you to live in the darkness. And so he pursues you, just like he pursues Adam and Eve with that very first question, where are you? All so that he can speak into the darkness of our hearts those most beautiful words of creation. Let there be light. Let there be light that I may see you. Let there be light that I may know you. Let there be light that in my light you might find the love and the fulfillment that your heart is seeking in the wrong places. But we don't accept it. We prefer often to stay in the darkness. We forget that the very fact that Jesus came into this world was to shine the light in the places, in the shadows of death, in the place where we walk in darkness. But it's so hard for us to comprehend. How could somebody love me that much? How could somebody care about me that much that they're actually willing to die for me? That they're willing to pay the ultimate sacrifice for me. It defies, in a sense, logic and reason. It's something that our minds cannot comprehend. But of course, where logic and reason find their limits, well, that's where love begins. And love, in fact, has no limits. Jesus proves that to us on the cross when he goes much farther than we would ever reasonably expect someone to go simply for little old us. One of my favorite Christian musicians, recording artists by the name of Torrin Wells, puts it this way. It's not one or the other. It's hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known and loved by God. It's hard truth. We have to acknowledge the fact that we're sinners. We have to acknowledge the fact that we have weaknesses, that we have wounds, that we have flaws. But it's ridiculous grace that God loves me, not in spite of my sins. He comes to save me because of my sins, with a love that goes deeper than my sins and my failings and completely transforms me from the inside out. You see, the path to holiness, the true path to holiness, is walking right in the middle of those two seemingly opposing but always simultaneous truths. On one hand, that I am a sinner. But on the other hand, that I am a beloved child of God. And that nothing about the first truth, nothing about the fact that I'm a sinner could ever change the second. And so God invites me out of that stance of shame. He invites me into the merciful light that flows from his sacred heart, pierced for us on the cross. He invites us to bathe in this light that we might be transformed and cleansed and purified and become indeed a new creation, risen from the darkness, risen from the ashes of our sins, and living forever in the light of God's merciful love. When the beast takes those very first steps into the light at Belle's invitation, he takes the first steps back to the fullness of his humanity. He takes the first steps into realizing that even in the midst of everything he has done and the mistakes that he has made, that if he allows himself to be fully known, he will also allow himself to be truly loved. God is making the same invitation to you and I, to step out of the darkness of sin and into the light of the resurrection, fully known, fully loved, fully redeemed, a tale as old as time.